Hello everybody, welcome to the lecture on the downstream processing in biotechnology. This lecture we will continue on the characterization process. I talked to you last lecture. We introduced the characterization process, the separation process. The final product or the product of this separation or this process is the pure crystal. Okay, for this lecture, we will start by the purity. The purity of the crystal, that's right. If crystal are allowed to grow slowly under constant condition, we can achieve the purity of the crystal that we obtain from the characterization is 99.5% to 99.8%. However, in the industrial practice, the varying level of impurity are carried out over from the material into the crystalline product. And also I talked already, the material from the characterization, we have at least two phase, solid phase and liquid phase. Liquid phase mean the material. The material include at least two components, solvent and solute. And another one for the solid phase. Solid phase is the pure crystal. The pure crystal. And then for the next step, maybe we would like to filtrate or filter the impurities, maybe by the step after the characterization, maybe by centrifugation or filtration. And after that, we can separate some solvent that attach to the surface of crystal by dry, for example. The mechanism by which the impurity infiltrate of crystal, there are at least three mechanisms that three or four mechanisms that impurity can attach in the crystal or incorporate in the crystal structure. Like for example, the first mechanism is adsorption or desorption of impurity on crystal surface. It's maybe some impurity, maybe adsorbed or attached to the surface of the crystal. For this case, we can remove to improve the purity of the crystal by washing by solvent, or we can recover by filtration or centrifugation. And the next mechanism is entrapment. It's maybe some material or solvent entrapped in the crystal during the crystal forming or during the crystallization process. It may be agglomerate. Agglomeration means a crystal impurity crystallize together. For this case, we can reduce the impurity by adjust some crystallization at conditions, right? We can adjust pH, you can adjust temperature, you can adjust solvent composition, for example, right? For this case. And the third one, there are sometimes inclusion or include of small quantity of material within the crystal. Within the crystal. For this case, we can remove the material out of the crystal by lowering the rate of crystal growth. That means we have to grow far slower. If you grow is faster, it's maybe some small amount or small quantity of the material increase in the crystal. For this case, we can solve by slow growing the crystal. And the last mechanism is substitution of impurity molecule within the crystal lattice. For this mechanism or the last mechanism is very difficult to remove the impurity because the impurity include in the crystal lattice, in the crystal structure. For this case, the removal of the impurity is only you can remove by dissolving the crystal in a solvent. It's maybe new solvent that is affect the solubility of the solute and impurity. And then we have to recrystallization. We have to recrystallize to yield a fresh preparation of the crystal and improve the purity. Sometimes we can recrystallize several times to improve the purity. This is the last problem because the crystal that include the impurity inside or in the crystal lattice, it's difficult to adjust the crystallization condition. It cannot remove by washing. But you have to solve this problem by recrystallization. By recrystallization, that means you have to dissolve the solute impurity again in the solvent and then recrystallize. If you did not get a pure, you have to recrystallize several times until you get the pure. Okay, the factor that you to calculate the impurity is we call it E. For example, EA means the impurity of solute A. For example, EA equal to weight of the solute A in crystal cake. In crystal cake, what does it mean? Cake mean the crystal and solution mixed together. Weight of solute A in the crystal, how much A or how much solid A in the crystal cake, and divided by weight of solute A in filtrate. What does it mean? After you separate crystal and molecule, the weight of A in cake divided by the weight of A in filtrate. You can calculate like the purity or in crystal. Similar equation you can write in impurity B, EB, weight of impurity B in crystal divided by weight of impurity in the filtrate. Filtrate means the solution or homogeneous solution or pure solution. That's right. There is only one phase, no solid in the solution. We call this filtrate. The liquid that can pass through the membrane then pass through the filter. We call this filtrate. Cake or crystal means the solid that cannot pass through the filter or pass through the membrane. That's it. Maybe include the solution in the crystal cake, and then you can compare the purity between A and B. You can calculate by beta term. Beta is the ratio of EA and EB. If the beta is large, the separation is effective because EA is greater than EB because the crystal is A, impurity is B. If beta is large, okay, we can separate A is easier and we get pure A. For example, right? For this example, a mixture of the sigma steroid and cytosterol, weighting 2,040 kilogram, is divided into fraction by crystallization. After crystallization, we crystallize into two fraction. The origin mixture contains 86.5% sigmosterol, and another is balan. The balan is 13.5 is the cytosterol. After the crystallization, the recovered crystal after crystallization include 96.6% sigmosterol with the weight of 1,137 kilogram. The solid in liquor contain 74.6 sigmosterol and found by the evaporation to dynamic. We can calculate it by you evaporate the solvent out and then you weigh the crystal. Okay, for this it determine the beta where you for this separation. The beta where you we can calculate the first one E sigmosterol and E cytosterol. For the first we calculate E sigmosterol. This is the amount of sigmosterol in sigmosterol in crystal cake divided by infiltrate. (clears throat) 1,137 kilogram. This is weight of the crystal after the crystallization. This is amount of the sigmosterol in the crystal in the crystal cake. The total weight is 1,137 kilogram of the crystal cake. But for this case, include 96.6% of sigmosterol. That means amount of sigmosterol in the crystal cake is equal to the total mass multiplied by 0.966 is the fraction of the signature divided by amount of signature in the filtrate. In the filtrate, from the mass balance, we know that the initially we have 2040 kilogram. After characterization, okay, the filter cake is 1137. That means a filtrate is 2040 minus 1137. This is the amount of filtrate. This amount of filtrate. In the filtrate, how much thick material include in the filtrate? This is 74.6%. That means you multiply amount of filtrate with the fraction of signature. This is amount of signature in the filtrate. From the definition, EA is A in crystal cake divided by A in filtrate. This also stick moisture in crystal divided by in filter cake, we get 1.63. And then you calculate E citral. How much E citral in the filter cake? In the crystal cake, 1137 kilogram include stick moisture 96.6 and only 3.4 of stick moisture. Only four of stick moisture. This is only 3.4%. That means amount of this in the filter cake is 1137 multiplied by 0.34. That's right. Get this. 1 minus 0.6966. This is the fraction of citral in the cake, and this is the total amount in the filtrate multiplied by the percent of fraction of citral in the filtrate. Citral filtrate. How many is the stick moisture is 44.6, and citral is 23.4. That's it. And then you get 0.168 is the E citral. And for stick moisture is 1.63. And then you calculate beta. Beta is the E stick moisture divided by E citral. You get 9.6. This is a log value. It's log value. It's greater than one. This means we can separate signature by characterization and you get the high purity because it's about 9.6. The technique to calculate the purity of the crystal, there are many techniques. The one technique that is most common used like the XRPD. XRPD means X-ray powder diffraction. Mostly we have two kinds of X-ray diffractometer. We have one is powder. That means the sample is powder. Another one is single X-ray. That means the sample is only one crystal. The most common industrial we apply the XRPD, X-ray powder diffraction. For this case, we use the X-ray equipment to measure the crystal. For the crystal, in this crystal, we have the X-ray diffraction is different X-ray diffraction. For this case, in each peak, the representative of is crystal. For this case, show the mixture. So we have two form of alpha D-L-methionine and gamma D-L-methionine. This is a pure form of alpha. The pure form alpha. The representative peak that it represent the pure alpha, this is peak, is the representative of the alpha form. And gamma form, this is peak of gamma form. And another peak, it should be the same peak. That's why it's the same. But only this peak for gamma, this peak for alpha. For this case, you can use the bottom one is the pure alpha form. And the top one is the pure gamma form. And then we have the peak of gamma. There is no peak of alpha. And also there is no peak of gamma. And the peak between 100 gamma and 100 alpha is the mixture. If like 90% gamma, 10% alpha, there are some small peak of alpha. It's 20% alpha, that's we have a peak of alpha. And 35% and some peak of alpha is increased. 50% peak of alpha increased, but gamma is decreased, for example, right? Then finally, we get only peak of alpha. There is no peak of gamma because it is the pure alpha. We can use the technique to check if the pure or not. If it's pure, okay, this is pure gamma. This is pure alpha. If they have some mixture of peak this for alpha and peak this of gamma, we have both peak. That means it is not pure. It's a mixture of alpha and gamma. That means you can apply this technique to measure the purity of another crystal. And also we can confirm the purity by Raman spectroscopy. For example, we have the form B of L-histidine and form A of L-histidine. This is a pure form B. This pure form A. For this, for the pure form, this is form A, form B, something wrong, sorry. This is a pure form A. This is pure form B. Because this A equal to 1, that means mass fraction of A equal to 1. This mass fraction of A equal to 0 mean only B. This means only A. This A equal to 0.8 is 80% A and 20% B. A equal to 0.6 is 60% A and 40% B, for example. Right, for the, this is scientific peak and this. For PLA, there is some peak of this and the peak of this peak and this peak is almost equal. But from PLB, there is no this peak from PLB. And this is the peak of intensity of this peak is quite slow or is not great, that's that. When the amount of A increase, this peak increase, that's right, this increase, like this. And also we have some, this peak, right, occur when the form A is higher fraction. And also we can use the DSC to check the purity, Is it the DSC, the temperature after you heated the crystal? We have some heat flow. We add the heat flow to the crystal. If you add the heat, the crystal will increase the temperature until it reach the melting point. This point is the point that the crystal is changed from solid to liquid because it's melting. It's mostly we start to melting, maybe around this, right? It start to melting, but the melting point for this is the maximum. It is the all of the crystal melt to the liquid phase. We can see that alpha and gamma form of D-L-methionine, right? It's different in the melting point. It's also you can use the purity. We can use to check the purity. If it's mixture, there are some peak, right? For example, in the mixture, we have both this peak and this peak in the same, right? That's right, there's a mixture. If there is no mixture, we only one peak for the melting of form alpha and form gamma, Okay, we can use another technique, but I show you only like three techniques like XRD, Raman, and DSC, things like this. And the next way I will talk to you is the information condition that we would like to characterization. The characterization we start from the homogeneous liquid phase. It's only one phase, but there is more than one component in liquid phase. It's solute and solvent. Okay. If we would like to generate the crystal, you have to make the supersaturation. Okay, with this slide, we talk about the supersaturation. The critical phenomena in characterization process are the generation of new crystal. and crystal growth. The new crystal mean form the liquid solution of clear liquid. If you adjust the condition, if you adjust the equilibrium, aside, you disturb the equilibrium, and then you get the new crystal occur from liquid. There are some solid generated in the solution. We call this the new creation. The formation of new creation, we call this the new creation. And after new creation, we have the crystal in the solution. The crystal in the solution. And that we have some mass transfer. So use that in liquid phase can transfer to the surface of the crystal. That means crystal will grow to the larger size. We call it the crystal growth. We call it the crystal growth. Okay. For this case, the objective for the process, you would like to determine the crystal size and size distribution. So I talked to it, how to determine the crystal size, how to determine the size distribution by CF, by FBRM, by PVM, by microscope. We can use that technique to calculate the crystal size and size distribution. We have to measure. Okay, for the driving force, what is the driving force for crystallization? The driving force for crystallization is supersaturation. Supersaturation means solution at concentration is greater than equilibrium or greater than the solubility of the solute in the solvent. Okay. The superation means concentration at greater than concentration at equilibrium. Like for example, right, the equilibrium concentration or saturated concentration of sucrose in water at 25 degrees Celsius is about 100 grams per, for example, it's about 100 grams per 50 grams of water, for example. If we prepare the concentration is 150 grams per 50 grams of water, this concentration is higher or greater than solubility or greater than saturation. Okay, we call it the supersaturated. Supersaturation or the solution is supersaturated solution. That is the driving force because its concentration is greater than saturation or greater than solubility. For that case, we can crystallize. Sorry. Okay, what is the solubility? The solubility or the equilibrium state. The solubility is the substance in presence of solvent. That means amount or maximum concentration or maximum amount of solute that can be dissolved in solvent at constant temperature and pressure. This is the solubility. Mean the maximum amount of solute that can be dissolved in solvent at constant temperature and pressure. For the solution at solubility or at equilibrium state, we call it the saturated solution. Okay. Solution that have concentration equal to the solubility of solute in solvent, we call it the saturated solution. How about supersaturated solution? Supersaturated solution means the solution contain solute dissolved in solvent is higher than saturated concentration or higher than solubility. We call this is supersaturated solution. And how about undersaturated solution? Undersaturated solution means solution that contain amount of solute less than saturated concentration, with the undersat concentration. We can show you in this curve. Okay. This curve show you right the solubility diagram. We plot the concentration in y-axis and temperature in x-axis. And also, this is line for solubility, or it is saturated solution in this line, or solubility curve. And the zone below this curve, we call it undersaturated solution. Undersaturated solution. For this case, if you add crystal, the crystal can be dissolved more, can be dissolved. That means there is no crystallization in this zone. Crystallization is impossible for this zone because if you add crystal, okay, you can dissolve crystal faster. The zone that's above solubility curve, we call it is supersaturation zone. Supersaturated zone. For for this case, we separate into zone, meta server zone and layby zone. This is also super saturated zone. For meta server zone, this zone is the concentration is above superiority, but it's quite small different. That's why it's small, but we cannot generate the new crystal in this zone. For this zone, we cannot generate the new crystal because the concentration quite low. It's quite low. That means is the driving force is low. If you would like to get a new crystal, you have to prepare the supersaturation in Lebesgue region or in Lebesgue. So it's super superiority curve. It's very high concentration. That's high super saturated or high driving force. For this zone, you can generate the new crystal from clear solution, from the clear solution. So in this zone, the crystal can generate from clear solution. But in this zone, it's difficult to generate the new crystal from the solution. But we can induce the crystallization by seeding technique. For this zone, in this zone, there is no new crystal from clear solution, but you can induce crystallization by seeding technique. That means you have to add some crystal, add some solid into the solution. And then the solute in the solution will transfer from the liquid to the surface of the crystal. And then the crystal will grow up to the larger size. If we call it the crystal growth, mostly the crystal growth occur in this zone. And also for this zone, we can generate the new crystal, but not from clear solution. It is come from the crystal. It may be the breakage of the own crystal, the shearing of the fluid in the surface of the crystal. We get the new crystal from the old crystal. That's why we call it the secondary nucleation. It may be come from the breaking of the crystal, from one crystal breaking in three crystals. Right, this is a description how to get the crystal. For example, like this. If we start from point A, that's right. You prepare the solution. The point A, it is the undersaturation region, undersaturated solution. In this, you cannot crystallize. That's right. You cannot crystallize. And then you cool, right? You decrease the temperature until you reach point B. This is T0. You decrease the temperature until T1. At T1, and the concentration is this. This concentration, at this concentration, and the temperature at T0 is undersaturated solution. There is no crystallization. If you reduce the temperature until it point B, at point B is mean the saturated solution at T1. That's right. It's the same concentration, right? The same concentration. But at point A, it is the undersat. Point B is the saturated solution. Point A and point B, there is no crystallization. If you decrease or reduce the temperature further, if you live in this zone, there is no crystal generation because you start from clear solution. Okay, there is no crystallization. And then you reduce further to point D. The point D, the crystallize, the solution is in maybe in T temperature 2. At temperature 2, this is the higher than temperature 1 and it's in the Lebesgue zone. Super superiority is high super saturation. And this zone, we can generate, the solution can generate the new crystal. So the new crystal, we call it the nucleation phenomena, nucleation phenomena. This is the technique, the crystallization by cooling crystallization. The main technique to generate the new crystal, that is mean the create the supersaturation. We have a lot of technique to create the supersaturation. I will talk to you later for this case. This is one example. You can generate the superset by cooling. That's right, by cooling. For this example, we cool from the underset. Under that, there is no crystallization until you reach the Lebesgue zone in the high supersaturation. At higher supersaturation, from the clear solution, the solution can induce the crystal generate during the characterization. And for this case, how much of the solute that characterize? For this case, you can calculate amount of solute that characterize from the different of concentration at this temperature. Temperature T2, the saturated concentration in this, this is the solubility curve or saturated concentration. At this, this is the set. For this case, at T2, you can characterize amount of crystal you can calculate for the difference from C2 like this and C1. Delta C, C1 minus C2 is amount of solute that you can characterize at T2. How about if you cooling further to TT, like example, this TT, this is set, CT, C1 minus CT is amount of crystal that can characterize at TT, for example. If you would like to get more and more amount of crystal, you have to cool at very low temperature. You can get more. That's right. You can get more for this technique, cooling characterization. And you have another technique like evaporation characterization, entire solvent characterization. I will take for this. I will talk this for the later. Okay. As I talk, the main driving force for the characterization is supersaturation. We can representative the characterization in terms of delta C or the driving force, or in terms of supersaturation ratio S or relative supersaturation or sigma. The driving force means the concentration, actual concentration minus C star. C star means the solubility or saturated concentration like this. Find from C1 is actual temperature. C star at T2 is C2, this C star. C1 minus C star is driving force of the characterization. And you can represent by ratio. S supersaturated ratio equal to actual concentration divided by C star. If C star equal to C, that means S equal to 1. There is no characterization. Or S equal to 1 or less than 1, there is no characterization. If S less than 1, that means concentration is underset. Concentration is underset. The characterization can characterize. The crystal can generate if delta C is greater than 0, S greater than 1, sigma is greater than 1, greater than 0 also. Right? Sigma is C minus C star divided by C star, S minus 1. If sigma equal to 1, that means C equal to sigma, it cannot generate the new crystal. That means, okay, delta C greater than 0, S greater than 1, sigma greater than 0. For this case, we can, the characterization can occur for the supersaturation. Okay, this show you an example of the solubility. All right, for the first, this is sodium corrosive nitrate. You can see that it's strongly dependent on temperature. As temperature increase, solubility of corrosive nitrate increase. But for sodium chloride, it's slightly increased with the temperature. And how about sodium sulfate? Sodium sulfate at lower temperature, if we increase the temperature concentration at equilibrium or solubility increase until it's greater than 40, the solubility will decrease with temperature, decrease with the temperature. And another example of the solubility is the solubility of citric acid. It's also a strong function of temperature. Temperature increase, solubility increase. This is for sodium glutamate, the amino acid, and sodium hydrochloric, the amino acid, and glutamic acid, this amino acid. It's also increased with temperature. Increased with temperature. This is the solubility of amino acid, the L-methionine. You can see it's also increased with temperature. Increased with temperature. For this case, this is methyl is zero. That means it's in pure water. In pure water, the methionine can dissolve higher in pure water. If you add some methanol, the solubility of the diamethylene in water is decreased. This is indicated the technique of anti-solvent characterization. I will talk to you later. At higher amount of methanol, at about 80%, solubility is very low value. That means if you have right, the first we have right, the methionine dissolved in water at this temperature, for example. And then you add some methanol at about 80% by volume, the solubility reduced to this point. That means we can crystallize by add some methanol. And how much amount of crystal can crystallize? This is the difference between concentration at this point. Concentration at this point and concentration at this point. This is the delta C amount of crystal can crystallize, can generate during the crystallize. We call this the anti-solvent crystallization. Anti-solvent crystallization, that means we add some another solvent that's difficult to dissolve in solute, but it's easy to dissolve in solvent. That means this is reduce the solubility of the solute in solvent, and you can crystallize easily. And it shows you the effect of PS on the solubility. Effect of the PS on the solubility. This is talk about precipitation process. This is the minimum solubility, this isoelectric point. Isoelectric point, as you adjust the PS, as you increase from 2 until 4, to get the solubility is decreased, and until 4 to 6 is quite constant. And then if you increase further PS, the solubility is increased. You can crystallize at minimum. This is a minimum solubility. That means you can crystallize. For example, if you start at this point, concentration is about 0.16. And then you add some sodium hydroxide to the system. Because sodium hydroxide, if you add pH, will increase until it's 4. pH is 4. That means this is delta C. You can crystallize. You can crystallize. If you increase the pH further, no crystallization because you increase the solubility. That means crystal can dissolve back to the solvent for that case. It's also another PS effect for the solubility of glutamic acid. Okay, for example, that's right. We had 10 kilograms of adipic acid in slurry in 13.1 kilograms of water. What this means, we have 10 kilograms of adipic acid dissolved in 13.1 kilograms of water. So, and we heat up to 90 degrees Celsius to solubilize the acid. We dissolve 10 kilograms of adipic acid in 13.1 kilogram water at temperature of 90 degrees Celsius. And then the solution is filtered and to remove insoluble impurity. Impurity during the heating and filtration. For this case, 10% of water is evaporated. The clarified solution is cool to 35 degrees Celsius and filtrate. The solubility at 35 is 0.05 kilogram acid per kilogram of water. Okay, the question determine the weight of crystal recovered in this operation. How much weight of the crystal can recover or can separate, can generate? For this case, we have to make the mass balance to solve this problem. If you recall the general mass balance, it input minus output. Part generation minus consumption equal to accumulation. For this case, there is no reaction. There is no new chemical, new substance. Okay, no generation, no consumption. And for most, we talk about the final and initial step or input output continuity. That's right. There is no accumulation. That means if you balance based on water, water input equal to water output. At the liquor and water output by evaporation. For this case, we have two cases. Water removed out by evaporation and water still in the liquor or in the solution. Right. The start of water is 13.1 kilogram of water and water out with liquor or with the solution there is anode. And how much water evaporate? Water evaporate is 10% of water in the feed. That's right. 10% is 0.1 multiplied by 13.1 kilogram. And then you can calculate water out the liquid. You get 11.79. That is balance. Input is 13.1. Output is this term plus this term. You get the same. Input equal to output for that case is the water balance. And the next step, we balance on the crystal. The crystal. For this case, there is no generation, no consumption, and no accumulation. Okay. Amount of solute in the feed equal to amount of solute in the crystal out and amount of solute remaining in the motor liquid. As I talked to you earlier, after you crystallize, you contain two form, liquid and solid form. Solid form mostly is solute, and liquid form contain at least two components, solvent and solute. For this case, we balance on solute. Solute it at the initial or solute input equal to solute in the crystal or pure solute in crystal, as I and solute that dissolve in the liquid or dissolve in the solvent. Okay, you know the solute input is 10 kilogram. It's 10 kilogram. Solute in crystal out is unknown, and solute remain in the motor liquid. What is the solute remain in the motor liquid? It's 0.05. It's 5%. How you know this is 5%? Because mostly the solution that remain after crystallization is saturated solution. Saturated solution mean the concentration at solubility. As I this mean the solubility. The solubility of solute in water at 35% is 0.05 kilogram per kilogram of water. It is 0.05 kilogram of solute per kilogram of water. This is kilogram of water. This is kilogram of water. You get, so for this, you get 9.41 kilogram. 9.5 kilogram, kilogram. Okay, for this case, the separation or the recovery can be increased by lowering the final temperature, because if you decrease the temperature further, like I show you previous, like this, if you lowering the temperature further, you get the more and more crystal generation or crystalline. But you get it for the cooling crystallization. For this example, we cool from 90 degrees Celsius to 35 degrees Celsius. However, during the cooling, there are some water evaporate for that case also. Okay, for the next example, for this case, we crystallize together with the filtration and dryer. We have 150 kilogram of saturated aqueous solution of silver nitrate. This is the feed silver nitrate solution. That means silver nitrate dissolved in water. Aqueous solution means water is solvent at 100 degrees Celsius. But this case, it cool to 20 degrees Celsius. For this phenomena, cool to 20 degrees Celsius, silver nitrate crystal can generate it. And then we filtrate the remaining solution. After the crystal, you get magma. The magma include crystal and molten liquor. That means silver nitrate crystal and saturated solution at 20 degrees Celsius, and then you send to the filtration. The filtration, the product is two form, right? Filtrate and filter cake. Have two form. The filtrate includes silver nitrate and water also. That's right. But silver nitrate in terms of liquid, not solid in this case. And in this cake, the filter cake, it includes silver nitrate crystal and solution. Supernatural crystal and solution. After that, you send it to dryer. Dryer, we have two products. Liquid water and crystal. Liquid water and crystal. Okay. For this cake, the wet cake, which contain 80% solid crystal. So for this cake is 80% solid crystal and 20% saturated solution. That means M2 is 80% is only supernatant crystal and 20% is solution for the filter cake. But the solution in this infiltrate and filter cake, we assume it at saturated state or at saturation at 20 degrees Celsius. For the first step for this case, you have to know what is the solubility at 20 degrees Celsius. At 20 degrees Celsius and also 100 degrees Celsius, you have to know this. You can solve for this. You can solve for this. Okay, for this case, we have M1, M2, M3, M4, M5 is unknown. But if you know the solubility, for example, we feed at 100 degrees Celsius for the solubility of supernatant at 100 degrees Celsius is 952 grams supernatant per 100 grams of water. And then you can calculate the concentration. Mostly concentration we can represent in terms of mass fraction. That's mean mass of supernatant divided by total mass. That includes water and supernatant. You get concentration in terms of mass fraction. 0.905 gram supernatant per gram solution. That means this equal to 1 minus 0.905 equal to 0.095 gram of water per gram total. This is at 100 degrees Celsius. And 20 degrees Celsius, the saturated solution contain 222 gram supernatant per 100 gram of water. And also you can convert to the mass fraction. That's right, mass fraction, you get this. This is the 0.689 gram supernatant per gram total. And also 1 minus 0.698 gram supernatant per gram total equal to 0.311 gram water. And then this is composition in saturated solution. It's composition in the input. Okay. This is the composition from the solubility of input of feed state. And this is the composition of saturated after crystallized in filter cake with composition in filtrate. And then you can follow the mass balance. Okay. For the composition of the filter cake, you can calculate M2 as the function of M3. For filter cake, we know right, 80% solid crystal and 20% saturated. That means you can know right, M2. M2 is the amount of crystal. Amount of crystal is 80% of filter cake. That's right. Filter cake is include M2 plus M3. That's right. This is the filter cake, M2 plus M3. But you know M2 equal to 80% of M2 plus M3. That means it's equal to 0 S multiply M2 plus M3. And then you can express M2 as a function of M3. M2 as a function of M3. Okay. And then you make the water balance. For this case, there is no generation, no consumption, and no accumulation. Water balance allows crystallization and filter. Allow crystallization and filter around this. Okay, we have only one input, two output. One input is water, 0.095 multiply 150 is the input of water. Right, this input of water. 0.095 gram water divided by gram total, multiply 150 gram total, you get kilogram of water. Okay, this is a kilogram. Water per kilogram total is 150 kilogram total, you get kilogram watt. This is input. How about output? Output we have two, that's right. Infiltrate and filter cake. Water infiltrate is 0.311 multiply M1. And in the filter cake is 0.311 multiply M3. Which is a, sorry, is a M3 plus M3. And mass around this total mass balance, this total. Total mass balance allows crystallizer and filter. This input is 150. Output is M1 plus M2 plus M3. 150 M1 plus M2 plus M3. You have two equations, two unknown we can solve because you know, right, m2 equal to 4 m3. We substitute m2 in this, is it only m1 and mt, m1 and m3. We have two unknown, two equations. You can solve for m1 and mt first. And then you know mt, you substitute mt into this, you get m2. Okay, now you can solve for m1, m2, m3. And then you can solve for m5 and m4. M5 and M4, you write the first, you use overall balance, overall silver nitrate balance, for overall, talk about the overall. Okay, for silver nitrate balance, input silver nitrate is 0.905 multiplied 150, this input. Output is 0.698 M1 plus M5. That's right, plus M5. M1 plus M5, you know M1 from previous balance, you can solve for M5. This is M5 mean the amount of crystal that you can recover is 122 kilogram silver nitrate crystal. And then percent recovery. Percent recovery is equal to amount of crystal recover divided by amount of solute in the feed. Amount of solute in the feed equal to 0.905 multiplied 100, this amount of solute in the feed. And this amount of crystal that recovered. Yeah. And then you can solve for M4. M4 is amount of water evaporated by overall mass balance. Overall mass balance equal to 150 equal to M1 plus M4 plus M5. You know M1 and M5, you can solve for M4. Is it amount of water evaporate from the dryer? This is a basic example for the mass balance for the ketorizer. And another example, for this case, an aqueous potassium nitrate. Solution contains 60% waste, potassium nitrate at 80 degrees Celsius. That's why we can calculate it by cooling ketorization. We cooling ketorization from 80 to 40. Degrees Celsius. Okay, for this case, determine the temperature at which the solution reaches a saturation and the percentage of potassium nitrate in the feed from crystal. That's from crystal. How the percent of the crystal form from the feed. Okay, for this case, the feed concentration must be converted to solute per solvent ratio because we use this graph to determine the concentration at solubility or at saturated solution. Okay, we can convert input. We have 60% weight of potassium nitrate and 40% of water. Okay, that means 60% gram of potassium nitrate divided by 40 gram of water, you get 1.5 gram potassium nitrate per gram water. But for this graph, you get gram per 100 gram. You modify both 100, you get 150 divided by 100 gram water. Okay, at this 150 gram, 150 gram. From this curve, the temperature is about 44 degrees Celsius. That means we feed at higher temperature than the saturated solution because the saturated solution is 44. But we feed at 80, that means the concentration at the initial state is super saturated. You can crystallize for this case. You can crystallize. And however, for this case, you also reduce the temperature to 40. Reduce the temperature to 40, and also you can crystallize more amount of the crystal. Okay, for this case, we set up the basis for calculation is 100 kilogram of feed. 1 kilogram of feed is 0.6 for potassium nitrate and 0.4 for water and 80 degrees Celsius in the feed. And output we have two, saturated solution and crystal at 40 degrees Celsius because in this is the in equilibrium or saturated. M1 amount of saturated solution, X is the fraction of potassium nitrate in saturated solution, M2 is amount of potassium nitrate crystal. We have three unknown, M1, M2, and X. You know this already. Okay. You can calculate x because x is the amount of solute or potassium nitrate in solution. We know that it is the equilibrium or saturated solution. You can calculate based on solubility at 40 degrees Celsius. At 40 degrees Celsius, the solubility is approximately 63 kilogram potassium nitrate per 100 gram water from this, about 63. Okay, you can calculate x. X is the fraction of potassium nitrate in saturated solution at 40 degrees Celsius. At 40 degrees Celsius, it's 63. That means 63 plus 100, because this is 63 kilogram potassium nitrate per 100 kilogram of water. Total mass is 63 plus 100. This is the total mass of solution. You get x equal to 0.386 kilogram potassium nitrate per kilogram total. And then you make a material balance. For this case, no generation, no consumption, no accumulation. Input equal to output. For water balance, water input is 0.4 multiplied 100. Water output is 1 minus x multiplied m1. So this water output. X is amount of potassium nitrate. 1 minus x is amount of water in the saturated. You see the input 100 kilogram of total multiplied 0.1 kilogram water per kilogram total is kilogram water. Output is M1. M1 is amount of saturated output multiplied fraction of water is 1 minus x 0.386 kilogram water per kilogram. For this case, only one unknown. You can solve for M1, 65.1 kilogram. And then you take the overall mass balance, total mass balance. Total mass balance. Total mass balance is equal to 100 plus 100 equal to m1 plus m2. You know m1, you can solve for m2. Right. You know m1, you solve for m2 is 44.9 kilogram potassium nitrate in the crystal form. And what is the percentage of potassium nitrate in the feed crystalline? How many percent of potassium nitrate crystalline? That means amount of potassium nitrate crystallized is 34.9. How amount of potassium in the feed? Amount of potassium in the feed is 0.6 multiplied 100. Sorry. Multiply 100, you get 58.2%. This is amount of percent of potassium nitrate that crystallization. How amount 41.8. 41.8% is included in the solution. This is 58.2%, and this is 41.2% in solution. Okay, in the last example for this lecture, this is for the solution solid. It's maybe some water included in the crystal, like we call the anhydrous crystal. That means water free. There is no crystal in, and no water in the crystal. The hydrous crystal means the crystal that includes water. That means water molecule bound to the crystal. For example, is magnesium sulfate. This anhydrous magnesium sulfate, no water, 100%. The condition to get this form is greater than 100 degrees Celsius. If you crystallize between 67 to 100 degrees Celsius, you can get magnesium sulfate, one water. That's because it's magnesium sulfate or no hydrate. You see the percent of magnesium sulfate. If you crystallize at 48 to 67 degrees Celsius, you will get magnesium sulfate, 6 water or magnesium sulfate hexahydrate. For example, this we call this hydrate or anhydrate. Hydrate, some water include in the crystal. Anhydrous, there is no water. Like for this example, an aqueous solution of magnesium sulfate at 104 degrees Celsius contain 30.1% of magnesium sulfate. It feed in the cooling crystallizer. We call the cooling crystallizer. At 10 degrees Celsius, that means we cool from 104 to 10 degrees Celsius. That means for this case, you have to know what is the saturated solution of magnesium sulfate at 140 degrees Celsius and 10 degrees Celsius. Okay, for this case, we know the saturated solution at 10 degrees Celsius is 22.2% of magnesium sulfate in the solution. Okay, the question is determine the rate at which the solution must be fed to the crystallizer, determine M1, to produce one metric ton, 1 ton or 1,000 kilogram of magnesium sulfate. Heptahydrate per hour. For this case, we will get the magnesium sulfate heptadehydrate. That means there is the hydrate form, not hydrous form. Okay, you can draw the flow chart. Input is M1, is the total amount of saturated, total amount of aqueous solution. For this case, at 140 degrees Celsius, contain 30.1 ton of magnesium sulfate per ton of solution. And another one is 69.9 ton of water per ton total. And output, for this case, you would like to get 1 ton or 1,000 kilogram of magnesium sulfate heptahydrate. This is the crystal. And also for this, after you crystallize, we have two phase, liquid phase and solid phase. Solid phase is the crystal, this is 1 ton. And M2 is the solution. M2 is solution. For this solution at 10 degrees Celsius, it's saturated solution, is come from the solubility. 23.28% magnesium sulfate. And 76.8% is the water. This is the saturated solution. Okay, for this case, we have only two unknown, M1 and M2, M1 and M2. And also the additional information, anhydrous magnesium sulfate molecular weight is 120.4. And magnesium sulfate heptahydrate, 246.4. This is the molecular weight. Okay, the first step, you balance the total mass balance allowed. For this case, no generation, no consumption, no accumulation. Total mass balance allowed the crystallizer. Input is M1. Output is 1 ton of magnesium sulfate heptahydrate plus M2. This is total mass balance, two unknown. Another one, you can make water balance or magnesium sulfate balance. For here, I make the magnesium sulfate balance. Magnesium sulfate input is 0.301 multiplied M1, is the amount of magnesium sulfate input. Amount of magnesium sulfate output equal to 1 ton of magnesium sulfate. But for this case, we include water also. As I, this is for 1 ton magnesium sulfate heptahydrate per hour. For this case, the molecular weight of hydrate form is 246.4 ton magnesium sulfate, 7 water. But for this case, include only 120.4 ton of magnesium sulfate. This is the molecular weight of magnesium sulfate. Because this is a molecular weight per mole, also molecular weight per mole. Okay, they can cancel mole. Like this. This is amount of magnesium sulfate in magnesium sulfate heptahydrate. And another magnesium sulfate also include in solution. Magnesium sulfate in solution is 0.232 multiplied M2. This is amount of magnesium sulfate in solution. M2, ton of solution per hour. This includes 0.232 ton of magnesium sulfate per ton of solution. Okay, for this case, we have two equations, two unknown, M1 and M2. You can solve for M1 and M2. M1 is amount of feed. You get 3.71 ton per hour, and M2 is the amount of solution after your crystallization. It's 2.71 ton. This is balance. This is balance. Okay, I will stop the lecture for this, and I will continue the crystallizer for the next lecture. Thank you for your attention.